is about the yes. thorax, right?
Yes.
So let's start with the thorax. So you all have skeletal system about the thoracic wall and the blood supply of the thoracic wall.
Yes.
All those, and even about the pectoral region, blood supply of the breast and all. Okay. And even the neck muscles, different triangles and different vessels, especially the carotid triangle, where you learnt about all the presence of the arteries. Okay. So let's first come to the thorax. To begin with, the main first the blood supply means both arteries as well as veins.
Yes.
So arterial supply and venous drainage, not supply.
Drain.
Veins never supply; they drain. Okay. Venous drainage and arterial supply. So first let's begin with the arteries which supply the structures in the thorax. Okay. So the structures in the thorax are the mainly the thoracic wall,
yes,
made up of the ribs, rib cages and the intercostal muscles, and the other structures like that is your the longitudinal structures which are running from neck and going to the abdomen, and even some structures ending within the thorax like trachea, the esophagus and all. Okay. So the important arteries that are present in the thorax are mainly they are branches from the subclavian artery. What are that?
Subclavian
artery. First part of the subclavian artery, which gives some branches which will run into the thoracic cavity and supply the thoracic wall. So and even branches from the aorta itself. Branches from the aorta. So let's begin with the aorta here. So you all know the aorta has having three parts,
yes,
right? So from the beginning, it ascends up. Okay, that is the ascending aorta up to this point. Okay, this is the ascending aorta, and then it arches, makes a U-shaped curve. Okay, that is called as the arch. And from here, it descends down. Okay, the descending aorta, ascending aorta, arch of aorta, and the descending aorta. Descending aorta in the thorax, it is called as descending thoracic aorta. When it comes to the abdomen, it is called as abdominal aorta. Okay. So now this arch of aorta, so ascending aorta, nothing much important vessels except the vessels which are supplying the heart itself, that is the coronary arteries, which will be not interested in this topic today. So that is a separate topic, so where we will learning about coronary circulation. Okay. So next is the arch of aorta. So arch of aorta will have three branches, three bigger branches. Okay. So here are the three big branches of the arch of aorta. Okay. So this arch of aorta begins, okay, and even ends at the sternal angle.
Yes.
What is that?
Sternal
angle. So begins at the sternal angle, runs upwards, and again ends at the sternal angle. That is angle of Lewis. That is junction of manubrium and the body of the sternum. Okay. So three branches. So from right to left. So first branch is the bigger branch compared to the other two. This is called as the brachiocephalic trunk. What is that called as?
Brachiocephalic
trunk, or also called as innominate artery. What is it called as? Innominate artery. So we remember it as brachiocephalic trunk. Because it's a trunk which divides into two branches. So here it is not shown. And I will show it here. Yes. So all of you can appreciate this. This is what is the brachiocephalic trunk dividing into two branches. One, this is the right subclavian and the right common carotid. Am I clear?
Yes.
You can very clearly see in this model. This is the right brachiocephalic trunk dividing into the common carotid and then the right subclavian. Okay. And then the other two branches are, whereas on the left side,
again.
The right brachiocephalic trunk dividing into right subclavian artery and the right common carotid artery. Okay, that's the one first branch from the arch of aorta. The other two branches are these two. The one which runs upwards towards the neck, this is the left common carotid artery. And the last branch is the subclavian, the left subclavian artery. This is the left subclavian, okay, and then left common carotid artery. They are the three branches from arch of aorta. Three branches from arch of aorta.
Left common carotid artery and the second what?
left subclavian.
Left subclavian origin.
Here on the right side, they take these two, common carotid and subclavian, they take a common origin with the trunk, which later divides into right common carotid and right subclavian. Whereas on the left side, they arise directly from arch of aorta. Okay? Now sometimes, even in some models I saw before, so there is one more small branch, sometimes it comes directly from arch of aorta, that is which supplies your thyroid gland. You already learnt in?
Yes. Sometime, not
all. Yeah, not all time. So what is that? Thyroidima artery, artery of thyroid gland, okay? So which arises from the arch of aorta directly, okay? Otherwise, three branches, what are they? Brachiocephalic trunk, left common carotid, left subclavian. Am I clear about the arch of aorta?
Yes, yes.
Okay, and then this arch of aorta runs downwards. That is called as the descending thoracic aorta. Descending thoracic aorta. This is what is the descending thoracic aorta. Can everyone see?
Yes.
Large. Big one. Yes, this is the descending thoracic aorta. So it gives very important branches in the thoracic cavity. So out of them, first is the right and left side, left and right posterior intercostal arteries. You can very clearly see here the arteries which are coming from this thoracic aorta. Can you see? Okay. Some are cut. So these are all the posterior intercostal arteries directly from this is descending thoracic aorta. And similarly, right posterior intercostal arteries. So these are also branches from the descending aorta which cross over the vertebral column and come on the right side. Posterior intercostal arteries, both on the right as well as left, they are given off from descending thoracic aorta. Descending thoracic aorta. Other than that, it even gives bronchial arteries for the bronchia and tracheae, okay, and even esophageal branches which also supply the esophagus. So these are the branches of descending thoracic aorta. Very important branches are the posterior intercostal arteries. What are they? Posterior intercostal arteries, both for the left as well as the right intercostal space. Am I clear?
Yes.
So this is about the aorta. So next, the other branches, what I was telling you about the subclavian artery branches. So you can see it in here. So I think you should get up to see this. So this is the subclavian artery. Okay. This is the subclavian artery. You can see two branches. One is this. Am I clear? And one more is this.
Yes.
Subclavian artery.
This is the subclavian. Okay. And one branch is this. Okay.
Yes.
That is very clear here. This is the anterior thoracic wall.
Yes.
Okay. So see here. This is the one artery. This is the same one. This is this one. Okay. This is the same. Okay. So here it is here. So they are from the first part of subclavian artery. First part, subclavian artery is divided by three parts by scalenus anterior muscle. What is that? Scalenus anterior muscle, the part of the artery which is medial to the muscle, behind the muscle and lateral to the muscle. From the outer border of the first rib, it continues as axillary artery which supplies your upper limb and the axillary. Okay, so first part of the subclavian, I will just show you the diagram. Because subclavian artery, there are no good models here. The first, the subclavian artery is like this, okay. You have a scalenus anterior muscle, okay. This is the first part, second part, third part, okay. So the important artery which is supplying the thorax is one is the superior thoracic artery or internal thoracic artery. These are the two arteries which supply the thoracic. So this is what is superior thoracic artery. This is the internal thoracic, or also called as internal mammary artery. What are they called as? Internal mammary. Other than that, it even gives thyrocervical trunk. Okay. And then vertebral artery. First part of the subclavian. It gives thyrocervical trunk. And then vertebral artery. So these are the three or four important branches from first part. Okay. Yeah. Internal mammary or internal thoracic, vertebral, thyrocervical trunk. thyrocervical trunk. So which gives rise to different branches like suprascapular, okay, then transverse cervical, inferior thyroid artery. That's why it is called as thyrocervical. The branches which supply the thyroid is inferior thyroid artery, and cervix neck region is the scapular arteries and even the transverse cervical artery. So they will be supplying the neck, and this will be inferior thyroid will be supplying the thyroid gland, inferior thyroid artery. Vertebral artery, you all know it runs. So bring
based
that.
On the brain. Vertebral.
Yeah, which the foramen transverse area of the all the cervical vertebrae runs goes into the cranium and supplies the brain, which operates form what basilar artery and all. Okay, that is the vertebral arch. So second part, sometimes on the left side it gives a trunk called as costocervical trunk. Costocervical trunk. And the third part, usually one branch, that is the dorsal scapula. Dorsal scapula. So first is mainly the first part. Okay, so out of which I shown you here, this is the internal thoracic or the internal mammary, and this is the superior thoracic. So this internal thoracic, you can see it very clearly here, which runs along the lateral border of the sternum on both the sides. It gives anterior intercostal arteries. These are all anterior intercostal. Can you see this red? They are branches from internal thoracic. Internal thoracic. Yeah? Superior, this here.
You can't see here.
No, no, it's here. It's not here. First, that is the branch which supplies only the first and second intercostal. It is, this is, I think this is below the sternal angle. Okay? Here, this is a small artery which supplies the first one or two intercostal spaces. Later, it is by the internal mammary. Internal mammary or internal thoracic. Okay? Any name. So this is the internal thoracic which gives off mainly the anterior intercostal arteries. So which later divides into two branches, terminal branches. One is this one, which is called, see, can you see this? It's running like this. This is the musculophrenic. What is that? Musculophrenic. And the other is the superior epigastric. See here. This is the superior epigastric, which goes into the rectus sheath, anterior abdominal wall. Okay. The other is the musculophrenic. You can say this internal thoracic ends at the sixth costal cartilage level. Okay. And then divides into musculophrenic, which supplies anterior intercostal to 9th, 10th and 11th intercostal spaces. Okay. The other part runs downwards vertically as superior epigastric. So anterior intercostal arteries are branches from, so you can see very clearly here, these are all the anterior intercostal. Okay. So they are branches from internal thoracic, which in turn is a branch from first part of the subclavian artery, first part of the sublime artery. So am I clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay, this is about the arteries in the thorax, arteries in the thoracic. So you remember the arteries in the thorax, mainly the arch of aorta, three branches from it, then descending thoracic aorta, posterior intercostal arteries, and then internal thoracic and superior intercostal artery. Internal thoracic and superior intercostal arteries are branches from first part of the subclavian artery. So internal thoracic gives rise to anterior intercostal arteries. So other branches from internal thoracic and even the descending aorta supply the esophageal branches, the tracheal branches or the bronchial arteries, they supply the other structures. Am I clear?
Yes.
This is about the arteries in the thorax.
Yes.
Arteries in the thorax. Whereas the veins, here the veins are very important in the thorax. So we have a separate system of veins. So everywhere in the body, as a basic knowledge of anatomy, you know that the veins run along with
arteries.
The veins run along with arteries. So here in the thorax, you have a separate system of veins, which we call it as the ajygus. A-Z-Y-G-O-U-S. Ajygus system of veins. What is that? Ajygus system of veins, which doesn't have same named arteries.
But the artery is thicker than...
Yeah?
The artery is thicker than...
Not artery, vein. Ajygus vein. It's the vein. It doesn't have same named artery. So that is the ajygus veins. So on the right side you have one full ajygus vein, which is this one. Can you see this? Okay, this is the ajygus vein. Okay, on the left side you find hemiajygus and accessory hemiajygus. So this is what is?
Hemiaegis.
Yeah, hemiaegis and accessory aegis.
Where is it?
So here, so they are joined continuously. Actually, You can consider here hemiaegis and accessory hemiaegis like that. Okay, the lower one is accessory hemiaegis and then hemiaegis wings. Okay, aegis.
Aegis.
Okay, so those are the, on the left side. On the right side, a big aegis wing. So they all drain the veins from the thoracic wall, like posterior intercostal and even the anterointercostal veins. They all drain into, and even the lumbar veins from the abdomen, they drain into this aegis vein. At last, this aegis vein drains into superior vena cava. This is what is superior vena cava. This is a very, very beautiful model to show you all the blood vessels and even the important structures, even the nerves in the thoracic cavity. Very good model actually. See here, even this you can make out. See here, this is what is the aegis vein. See this? This is what is the superior vena cava. Okay? So you can have lunch. That aegis vein arches over the right principal bronchi and drains it. See here, this is the right principal bronchus. Okay, arches over the right principal bronchus and drains into superior vena cava. The only tributary of the superior vena cava is aegis vein. How is the superior vena cava formed? No. Formation of superior aegis, superior vena cava. I'll come to this, okay? So this is the aegis veins. So other than this aegis veins, you have a bigger a vein which drains into your right atrium. What is that? Superior vena cava. Superior vena cava. Okay. Superior vena cava is formed by two veins. Right and left brachiocephalic veins. What is that? Right and left brachiocephalic vein. How these brachiocephalics are formed? Again by the union of subclavian. Internal jugular, very good. So subclavian and internal jugular, they form the brachiocephalic vein. So internal jugular and bringing the venous blood from the brain, and even external jugular which drains into the subclavian, which brings venous blood from face and neck. So even you have, so that is anterior jugular vein, okay, external jugular vein, all these veins at last they form two big veins, right and left brachiocephalic vein. They later join together to form superior vena cava. Superior vena cava, which drains into your right atrium. Am I clear? This is what is the superior vena cava. Superior vena cava. Only tributary which receives by the superior vena cava is the aegis vein. Aegis vein. Am I clear? So this is about the blood supply of the thorax. Blood supply of the thorax. So how is the superior vena cava formed?
From subclavian.
Right and left brachiocephalic vein. How are the brachiocephalic veins formed?
Subclavian and
internal jugular. Subclavian and internal jugular. Okay? Yes. Yes. So that's all about the blood supply of your the thorax. Okay. Next, come to the head and neck. Okay. So which is the principal artery of your the neck? It is the external carotid artery. The name only indicates external. It supplies all parts outside the cranial cavity. Internal means because it supplies the structures in the cranial cavity. That's why internal carotid. Okay? External carotid supplies much of the face and even the neck region. And even branches from the subclavian. Branches from the subclavian artery and then the branches of the external carotid artery. No branches from common carotid. Make it clear. No branches from common carotid and no branches from internal carotid in the neck. No branches from common carotid and no branches from internal carotid in the neck. The branches from the internal carotid arise only in the cranial cavity. Okay, no branches from common carotid and internal carotid in the neck region. So whatever the branches are there in the neck region, they are all from external carotid artery, and even branches from the subclavian, whatever I said already, transverse cervical, okay, suprascapular, all those scapular branches and the transverse cervical, which again divides into superficial and deep cervical branches, ascending cervical branches, they all supply the neck region. So now here you can, in the neck, you can make out the, this is the, as I explained already, the right side, the common carotid is from brachiocephalic trunk, whereas left side directly from arch of aorta. So this is what is the common carotid artery. Okay, this is the common carotid artery. This is the common carotid artery. Okay, which is dividing into, see, this is the internal carotid and this is the external carotid artery. Okay, internal and external carotid artery. Internal and external carotid. Here it is little confusing. So actually, we name these two arteries, branches of the carotid, internal and external, depending on the area of supply, not according to the position. Here, see here, this is the external carotid actually, but okay, it is more internal. It should be called as internal, but we call this as external, and this is internal. So don't be in a confusion. Whenever they, for example, they will tie this artery in the OSP, and don't be in a confusion that whatever the artery which is there inner side towards medially, this is the external, outer artery is the internal. Okay, so don't be in confusion here. So it's very hard, that's why this is difficult. So this is what, it's not clear, it's, you have to pull little the sternocleidomastoid. So here it's better, little clear. See here, this is what is the common carotid. Okay, dividing into the internal and external. External is inner side, internal is outer side.
To supply the face, because the face is external.
External, okay? Outer side is the internal carotid artery. So that's what I said. It's a misnomer actually, but we are naming them according to the supply. Like internal carotid, as it supplies the internal structures, it is called as internal carotid. As the other artery which supplies the external structures, we call it as external carotid artery. Okay? So where is that model? Yes. Yes, here. You can see it very clearly. This is the common carotid artery. It is given off behind the sternoclavicular joint. Where is that? Sternoclavicular joint runs upwards, okay, slightly under cover of your sternocleidomastoid muscle, deep, present within the carotid triangle of the neck, and runs upwards, divides at the level of the this superior border of
this external.
Yeah, this is external, this is internal. Okay, yeah, very close to each other. That's what I said, you should know the position. This one is external and this one is internal. Okay, yeah, so this is the external carotid artery, internal carotid artery. So where does the common carotid artery divide? Divides at the superior border of the thyroid cartilage. You know thyroid cartilage? So this is what is the thyroid cartilage. Okay, superior border of the thyroid cartilage into external and internal carotid arteries. This is the common carotid artery. So usually whenever you feel the hyoid bone is little above, usually there are variations. I'm not saying that particularly it always divides at the level of superior border of thyroid cartilage. There will be variation. Here it is shown at the level of the hyoid bone, but usually it is lower down at the border of the superior border of your thyroid cartilage. Okay, that is the usual division of common carotid into external and internal. Maybe an MCQ or whenever they may top point this, I ask you to identify the pinnate structure, and they may ask you where does it divide or where you can feel the pulsation. Very important. Where you feel the pulsation of carotid artery?
Superior border of the thyroid cartilage.
Pulsation of carotid.
Sternomastoid muscle. Near sternomastoid muscle.
Anterior tubercle of C6 vertebra. Transverse process of C6 vertebra. So that what it is called as carotid tubercle. Carotid tubercle. So where you always arteries pulsations are felt when they where they are lying directly over the bone.
Yes.
Okay. So there only you will feel the pulsations. Okay. Where the common carotid artery lies. So just you have to ask him to turn the patient, I mean subject, turn his neck slightly laterally. Okay. And then put your hand down.
Bush against the sternum.
Yeah. Not against. You have to go deep to the sternomastoid, not above the sternomastoid. If you put your hand above the sternomastoid, you cannot. Okay? So you have to go a little deeper. Deeper to sternomastoid. Like this, see here. Okay? And then slightly push forwards. You will find a bone that is the anterior tubercle of the transverse process. The transverse process divides into anterior tubercle and posterior tubercle. The sixth cervical vertebra. So on which you feel the pulsation of the common carotid artery. That is the carotid tubercle we see. Okay? So, somewhat in some olden movies you might have seen, like Superman, Batman or what they do. So usually, they'll just poke it here and the patient will go for unconsciousness. I mean the subject, villain. How? So he will be obstructing the carotid. Okay, well, when you obstruct the carotid, what happens? Blood supply to internal carotid is lost. So then, you will go for unconsciousness. Okay? Yes. So that is the common carotid artery. Okay? Divides at the upper border of the thyroid cartilage into external and internal carotid artery. So now, this is the external carotid. We are interested in external carotid, not the internal carotid. Okay? So, external carotid artery gives off many branches. They are superior thyroid artery. See here. I will label all this. Superior thyroid, which supplies the thyroid gland, and even it gives a laryngeal branch which supplies the larynx.
Okay.
Okay? So, be careful in observing this model. So, they may, what is that, point any of these branches. Okay, what is this branch?
Laryngeal.
Superior thyroid artery. Okay. One of the branches is laryngeal. Mainly the superior thyroid artery. Okay, and so, then?
Laryngeal is a branch of superior.
Yeah. So then this is the lingual artery.
Lingual artery.
This is the lingual, which is going below the hyoglossus. Mm. Deeper one, only small part is seen. This is the lingual. And this is what is the facial, which comes over the mandible and then runs up in the face. That is the facial. So I told you three. Superior thyroid,
and the branch of
lingual, facial. So these are all the anterior branches. They are the anterior branches. The posterior branches, so one will be, actually there will be two. Here it is only shown one artery. So one is the occipital artery, which goes deep to the back muscles and then comes on the posterior side of the scalp, supplies the back of the neck as well as the scalp. Occipital, and even you will find one more which runs here, that is the posterior auricular.
It's not here.
Not here, Dr.
Trump. Okay. So, two posterior branches, what are they? Occipital line, posterior auricular. Posterior auricular. And then still runs upwards just behind the neck of the mandible. Neck of the mandible, it divides into two terminal branches, maxillary and superficial temporal. So you can see it here very clear, superficial temporal. Superficial temporal. If you put your hand just in front of your tragus of ear, you can see the pulsations. What is that? Superficial temporal artery. Superficial temporal artery. Superficial temporal. Okay? So which supplies the scalp? Which supplies the scalp? Okay? That is the superficial temporal. And this is what is the facial. See here. This is the facial artery. Okay? In the model I am showing. Try to observe. These are the superficial, that is the facial artery. Okay? So which are different branches.
Can we feel this facial artery?
Yes.
Facial, yeah. So how you feel the pulsation of the facial artery? Yes. For that, where exactly you feel? Where it is lie directly over the mandible? Where?
Yes.
Anterior inferior angle of the masseter. To clench your teeth. It's a quadrangular muscle, masseter. Okay? Anterior inferior. Here. Here, you put your finger. You can feel? Anterior inferior angle. So for that you have to clench your teeth, make the masseter prominent, just go in front over the
lower border of your mandible. Not here.
Here.
Okay? So that is the facial artery pulsation. That's what, that's why they usually, the anesthetist, whenever this patient is undergoing surgery, we call this facial as anesthetist's artery. Because the whenever the patient is on the operation table, all his parts are covered. So how will you, he cannot go in between the surgeon and feel the radial pulse. So how will you monitor the pulse rate? He will go for facial artery. Because anesthetist will be standing at the head end of the patient. Okay, you will feel this pulsation and then record the pulse rate. Okay, this is the superficial temporal. So here in this model, you can very clearly see the maxillary artery and its branches. See this? This is the maxillary artery. So maxillary artery is a very important branch which supplies much of the structures here. So maxillary artery here, this is, what is this area? Infratemporal area. Infratemporal region, we say. Below the temporal, this is the temporal bone. Okay, below the infratemporal area. So it is divided again, maxillary artery is divided into three parts. Bilateral pterygoid muscle.
This large.
Lateral pterygoid muscle divides the maxillary artery into three parts. So if you consider this as maxillary artery, so here is the lateral pterygoid muscle. First part, second part, third part. Okay? So important branches are from first, mainly the middle meningeal artery. Which foramen it passes through?
This artery?
Middle meningeal artery.
Mental?
Middle meningeal artery passes through mental. Mental foramen is there in the mandible. You already learnt about the skull. So very important are middle meningeal, accessory meningeal, okay, deep temporal. Okay, and very one more important branch is inferior alveolar. What is that?
Inferior
alveolar, which runs in the mandible, in the mandibular foramen, which supplies all the lower jaw tooth. And mainly first part you have posterior superior alveolar, which supplies your upper jaw. And we have spinopalatine branches, nasal branches, many branches from maxillary artery. Like mylohyoid artery. All the vessels here, they are all branches from maxillary. You can see many branches here. See this?
Yes.
So this is the inferior alveolar nerve, which is running in the mandible. Am I clear? Okay. So along with this, this artery is running. Okay, which is cut actually. Okay, inferior alveolar artery. This is the full maxillary artery. Maxillary artery. There are many branches actually. See, this is your middle meningeal artery, which is going up into the skull. Okay, so rest of the part, it runs in the pterygopalatine fossa, which divides, which again gives first branch, that is branches to the upper teeth, spinopalatine branch supplying the spinodensolescence and the ethmoidal air sinuses. They all the branches from this maxillary artery. Okay, so what are the terminal branches of external carotid? Terminal branches of external carotid.
Superior thyroid.
Terminal branches. Maxillary and superficial temporal. Where does the external carotid artery divide?
Superior thyroid cartilage.
No. Where does this external carotid artery divide into terminal branches? Neck of the mandible, just behind the neck of the mandible, it divides into two terminal branches. So what are the branches of the external carotid? Superior thyroid artery, lingual artery, facial artery, okay, posterior auricular, occipital, superficial temporal, maxillary. And sometimes even you find one more very small branch, that is the ascending pharyngeal. Ascending pharyngeal.
Where is mandibular here?
Mandibular?
Yes.
No. Mandibular artery is not there. It's the maxillary artery. This is the maxillary. Superficial temporal. Yeah, superficial temporal. Dividing into many branches, which will supply over the scalp area. Okay? So the facial artery runs in the face, giving labial branches, superior labial, upper labial, inferior labial, nasal branches. Okay, they all supply the face. Okay, and even you will have some of the branches from internal carotid. So internal carotid artery within the cranial cavity, it gives a branch called as ophthalmic artery. What is that called as? Give me that mold here. Ophthalmic artery, yeah. So this is supratrochlear and supraorbital. Supraorbital and supraprochlear. They are branches from internal carotid. Ophthalmic artery is given off within the cranial cavity, which runs through the orbital canal. Okay? So some branch, after going through the orbit, it will come out through these foramens.
Yes, sir.
Even infraorbital, here not shown. Infraorbital, this foramen, infraorbital will come. That is a branch from maxillary artery. So many branches from maxillary artery. Many branches. So this is a story about the artery supplying the head and neck area. Okay? Okay? So then the veins. The veins, the very important veins of the neck, we divide it into your superficial vein and deep vein. Superficial veins are mainly two. What are they? External jugular vein and anterior jugular vein. External jugular vein and anterior jugular vein. And deep vein is internal jugular vein. Internal jugular vein and the veins which run along with the arteries. Okay? So external jugular vein is formed just behind the angle of the mandible by the union of posterior branch of the retromandibular vein, which you will learn when you go to the... I think you already learnt it in the first year. Blood supply of the face.
Yes.
Okay? Blood supply of the face. Formation of the retromandibular vein. Retromandibular vein is formed by the posterior auricular. Then this retromandibular is formed by maxillary vein and superficial temporal vein. So superficial temporal vein, maxillary vein to form retromandibular vein, which divides into anterior and posterior division. Anterior vein is joined by facial vein to form common facial vein. Posterior division of retromandibular vein joins with posterior auricular vein to form external jugular. How is the external jugular vein formed? You already learned. When was the lecture? Day before yesterday or yesterday?
That's
Sunday. So hardly 2 days. External jugular vein is formed by posterior auricular vein. And then posterior division of retromandibular vein. This is the only area where the vein divides. Nowhere in the body vein will not divide. Vein is formed.
Yes.
Oh, whereas here, retromandibular vein, a vein called as retromandibular vein. How is it formed? Formed by superficial temporal and maxillary. Superficial temporal and maxillary. They join together to form retromandibular vein. Okay, retromandibular divides into two, anterior division and posterior division. So posterior division is joined by posterior auricular. Posterior auricular behind the neck of the mandible to form external jugular veins. External jugular vein. It's a superficial vein. Very lean, thin pupils they can make out, especially during deep inspiration. Take a deep breath, very prominent veins, especially when lifting some weights or something. Okay, you can see the very prominent external jugular vein. Very important clinically. Very important clinical. So this is the external jugular vein. So which drains into subclavian vein. Which drains into subclavian vein. So anterior jugular vein formed at the chin area, which runs anterior to sternomastoid muscle, which again drains into your external jugular vein. So okay? And then internal jugular vein. Actually, it's the main vein which carries venous blood from brain. Internal jugular vein. Internal one way to learn is external jugular. One is the internal jugular. So internal jugular
from the brain.
Yeah. So it comes out of the continuation of the dural venous sinuses. Which is the vein? Comes out. Internal jugular vein, transverse sinus and then sigmoid sinus continues down as internal jugular vein. cranial cavity. I don't know whether you remember or not. Give me that. Dural venous sinuses. So what is this? Straight sinus. Okay. Transverse sinus. Continuous as sigmoid sinus. So which passes through the jugular foramen, comes out as internal jugular vein. Continuation of the sigmoid sinus out the jugular foramen is the internal jugular vein. So it comes out, okay, and then joins with the subclavian to form the brachiocephalic vein. Joins with the subclavian to form the brachiocephalic. So right brachiocephalic, left brachiocephalic, similar, left jugular, left subclavian. So then they both join together to form superior vena cava. Am I clear?
Yes.
So this is about the veins of the head and neck region. Okay. So very, very few veins, very important, prominent veins I have told you. So there are, for like, when you go, you already studied that, for example, blood supply of the face, you have learned many details about supraorbital vein, supratrochlear vein, angular vein, facial vein, common facial vein, all those things you have learned. To be in brief, the important veins I said, that is external jugular, anterior jugular and internal jugular veins. Okay? So this is all about the blood supply or the blood vessels of the head and neck region as well as the thoracic region. Am I clear?
Yes.
Okay. So look into the models. If you find any difficulty, you can ask, you can clarify it here. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah.